Disaster Restoration and Temporary, members of the Great University of Benin Alumni Association, Greatest University, family members, members of the press, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, permit me to thank the immediate past Vice-Chancellor, Professor Ochi Oshodi, for accepting me to do my sabbatical leave at the University of Benin during the 2013-14 academic session. Professor Ochi Oshodi also recommended me to the University Council in 2014 to be employed as an associate professor after the expiration of my sabbatical leave, an interview conducted for the above position, arising from the urgent need for lecturers in the Department of Science and Laboratory Technology. Sir, on your part, as his successor, I thank you for crowning me as a full professor in October 2017. That is 3 years after I joined the University of Benin as an academic staff. Hitherto, I have been working at the Nigerian Institute for Health and Research University as a research officer. The implications of the above background point to the fact that I have spent more years in purely research sector than in the university sector, where teaching and research are routine practices. Consequently, my presentation shall cover most of the researches I conducted at NIFO and the few years I have spent at the University of Benin. I have not been opportune to provide to graduate students in the Department of Science and Laboratory Technology and is just at its teaching stage. I am about to graduate the first full-time BSc student. However, I fulfill as the first professor of chemistry in the department and the first professor in the department to deliver an inaugural lecture. And therefore, I wish to thank the Almighty God who prepared me ahead from the research sector for an academic sector for enabling me to meet the rigorous requirements for the attainment of the position of a professor. The Nigerian Institute for Health and Research has 4 mandate palm crops: the oil palm, nut palm, raffia, ukra palm, and date palm. By the special grace of God, I have done researches in all the palms, and I did my PhD on the staff of raffia, ukra palm, which I shall report upon the year after. I have provided 40 project work for BSc students in chemistry and biochemistry. Introduction. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I shall limit my presentation to the areas below, being some of the segments of my entire work due to the time allocated for this lecture. 1. Analytical work done and findings of the golden tree. 2. The products derived from the golden tree. 3. The research done on my environment and community. 4. The perception of on the sap of the golden tree and the full chemist's judgment. So I would want to just introduce us to what food chemistry is all about. I try to summarize this in a very short manner. There's more than this. So for those of us who are not in that field, food chemistry involves chemical processes and interaction of all biological and non-biological components of food. Biological substances include carbohydrate, lipid, protein, water, vitamins, minerals, enzymes, food additives, flavors, and colors. The study of food chemistry also encompasses processing procedures. The food chemists are concerned with how food products are processed, prepared, and distributed. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I should like to mention here laid the foundational blocks upon which I laid further blocks to become a professor of food chemistry. In 1973, the Nigerian Institute for Health and Research, Benin City, offered me my first permanent appointment, and I was to make use of chemistry in my routine work as a young secondary school leaver. And I was posted to the biochemistry research laboratory of the institute, where I worked as a research technician with a research chemist, Mr. Ipe P.I., an Indian, and Dr. D.A. Oki, retired executive director of NIFOD. Again, the analytical procedures for my routine job further entrenched the love of chemistry into my heart, which I have loved so much from my secondary school days. The climax and final block was laid for me to build upon when I was offered scholarship by NIFOD to proceed to the University of Ibadan in 1975 to read science and technology and to major in chemistry. Professors Ogunmo M.E. and Obiawe A.P. of Chemistry Department, University of Benin, were my PhD professors. The journey. Well, I want to thank God for today. It has been a very long journey. But the joy I have is that, just like one of my directors was, when I visited him to invite him, he was telling me that we would want to be here. I wonder why Dr. Oki is here. This is however you desire, I was ready, damn it. My Vice-Chancellor, sir, before I continue, let me thank the management of Nigerian Institute for Health and Research University that trained me at the University of Ibadan between 1975 and 1980, at the University of Benin between 1996 and 1998, and 2003-2005 for my master's and PhD respectively. Without the scholarship granted to me by NIFOD, I would not have been able to acquire the above qualifications as fast as I did because I lost my father at the tender age of 4 years. However, I thank God who stood by me after I had spent 90% of my service years at NIFOD and to join in the building of the Science and Laboratory Technology Department at the University of Benin. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, I thank you very much for our relationship, which is over 45 years now. And by God's grace, it is still growing stronger and stronger. Thank you, sir, for announcing me as a good professor of New Chemistry in 2017, and also for approving this lecture for today. May the Almighty God continue to keep you and your family as the apples of his eyes. Amen. At this point, I want to go straight to the matter for today. We have seen all the banners around and all advertisements that have been made. The topic of this study or this lecture is the golden tree, the neglected daily life supporter, and the food chemist judgment. The tree that we are seeing there is the tree we are going to discuss. You know, we that came from the research sector, like I introduced earlier on, we work with trees. If you work at NIFOD, we have four mandate crops. Arabia happened to have been the second one. We have coconut, we have the oil palm, we have the others. But however, I chose to look at this raffia because in 2005, my director visited here when I was being posted to go to Wine Bottling to go ahead the place. And I went to him as my brother and as my boss. I was not going to go. I don't know what Brendan will say. And I'm going to head a place where my wine will be produced. I somebody who encouraged me, I think I cannot forget, say, Francis, you don't know what the future has for you. I should go. If I should reject, it might count against me for my future. And I said, yes, sir. And I went. So I want to thank you for your counsel. And so it, after we agreed on that and I went, in short, every director that came, including himself, nobody could change me. They said, oh, I'm very adequate for that place. I should still go with genetic form. Please, are you okay? I want to, see, when you look at the title, it said it's 43. One may want to begin to wonder why we have to call it that way. We all know the value of gold, even in chemistry. The chemists define gold as a chemical element with the symbol AU and atomic number 79, making it one of the higher atomic number elements that occur naturally. In its purer form, it is a bright, slightly reddish, yellow, dense, soft, malleable, and a ductile metal. Gold is not harvested on the surface of the earth. The miner has to pass through all kinds of rudiments on the earth's crust to obtain gold in its impure state that may not be appreciated by those that will make use of it. The uses of gold are so numerous. It has found its uses in domestic and industrial sectors, apart from its revenue-yielding ability. It is prestigious to win a gold medal in any event involving competition. Research on the golden tree has been neglected by most researchers as a non-lucrative tree for research. There is a popular Benin adage which says, except you enter a house, you will not know the content of the house. I try to liken this to this tree. See, until you enter the house, the room here, you don't know the content of that room. So until I entered into the study of this plant, I didn't know what was inside. So it is what we have seen inside the house that we are reporting today. But before now, I want to also say that just last month here, July, Research Gates wrote a letter to me that this work has been read by 700 people in the world and it has been cited. So it has gone internationally. And we know what it is for them to write to you and say your work has been published and 700 people have cited and published it. So I am proud to hear that from them. I thought we were just doing minor work and they could value what came out of that work. So research on the golden tree has been neglected by most researchers. And as a non-lucrative tree, it is very common with those that came for research. If you are posted to Philadelphia in the program, some people see it as a punishment. But we are leaving behind today in our manual a very good thing that we will read about that plan. So it's not a punishment zone at all. And I must also announce here that is where I also used the palm I also used for my PhD, which the University of Benin conferred on me. So this is the tree, as you can see, very rugged to climb, unlike what you find in coconut and in the oil palm tree. Very rugged, those that have to climb, there are a lot of work that has to be done before you can climb it up. And on the right part of it, you will find that there is a groove of raphia. And before you can get to the groove, there are all kinds of roads you have to pass through. Tons and all that, you have to deal with on the way. The body, you know, don't talk about what happened to the body again. So it's a very rough and rugged area for research. And besides that, they are found in the river Rhine area. Very tough area. There are some areas you have to also go with canoe. Because you cannot just go on the ground. You have to use the little paddle canoe to carry out the work. So when you now compare that with what it is to do research in that area if you want to really do research. So, Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, let me begin to unveil the key words of this title of this lecture. The tree I call the golden tree is the raffia okra palm. The palm has been shown to be of tremendous benefits to man, and there has been little or no conscious effort to domesticate the tree or cultivate it in large plantations. In short, many scientists do not accept raffia palm as a domesticated crop. Lack of adequate knowledge about the tree's usefulness, botany, physiology, products, and methods of cultivation of the raffia palm has contributed to the neglect of the palm in 2003. The habitat of the palm is the swampy tropical area, rainforest, flanked by all kinds of roots and thorns with difficult terrain to move and walk and carry out the activities of tapping and removal of sap or wine tap into the recans. The labor input may be equated to that of gold mining. Unlike the other palms, each of the raffia palm tree yields an average of 50 liters a day that must be carried among the rough goods, or as described above. In some of the sites, like I have said earlier on, you have to use canoe to get there, before you can bring it all out. But let me pause that to explain to us, to this audience, because many of us see that tree as an alcoholic tree. So we want to, by God's grace, let us know today so that we know what that tree is supposed to be. Right from the time it raffia palm is tapped, we don't expect it to be alcoholic. There are a lot of activities, there are a lot of actions, like the enzymes and all yeast that are part of it will cause after you have tapped it. So it's not that because it's called an alcoholic tree that you think is alcoholic. So it takes some time, we took time to now measure, took time to ensure that by the time you tap the sap and you tap the tree and you get the sap, we have found that if you decide to distill the sap within the first six hours, you will not be able to get up to 0.5 ml of alcohol from it. So if you are able to tap and bottle the wine within the next 3 hours, 4 hours, the product you get, if you try to give it to even a young child to drink, that child will not be intoxicated. So we should be careful until we go into research, we don't understand what is happening. And we have tried various harvests that we took after 1 hour, after 2 hours, to feed rats with this. Until you get to the next day, if you feed rats with it, the rat will still be very active. Maybe there's no effect of alcohol on it, even the rats, until the next day. That's part of it that we say we must look into before we can present a product that everyone should be able to do. Bottling and competing with knife that treat them. And so they came out with various kinds of bottled palm wine. They were adding, they go to the bush. If you ever visit the bush where the palm wine is being tapped, you will never drink palm wine again in your life. Because the pots that the papas use to store their palm wine, it's not even washed. And so every day they add to what they have there. The flies should have died there, other things should have died, bees should have died there, all the other things should have died, and then bring it out to come and hawk and give people to drink. So, this is do your work, go and do it in a more hygienic way. So, there is no wine that will come and give to you to buy that you think is not adulterated. Don't ever believe that. I have gone to the beer site and I've seen what they do. So I want to recommend that the kind of lecture we are giving today is on the fermented sap. The fermented sap SAP has a constitution of 90% water. You have proteins, you have various vitamins, you have various elements in the SAP. But the and that is called the PAM SAP. The one they call special, when you drink it, the one they call special, the one you buy in the bar, I will also tell you what you have inside. You almost have less than 0.5 of alcohol in it, sorry, of sugar in it. And you have acid, acetic acid is the actual acid that you have inside of it. I'm talking as a chemist, I'm sorry. So acetic acid, we know what danger it can cause in the body. So you have that inside, and all that nutrients are supposed to be there, apart from the minerals, nothing that is remaining. And so it's not safe. So we're not discussing that one today. We are introducing to us those that have to take it. You must look for the where it is labeled, where they have less than 0.05%. And if you have 0.05% of alcohol in it, you are almost having 8% sugar in it. It's just the natural pan can give you up to 10 to 12% sugar in it. That you can't get more than that. So if anyone you find in the street is less than 0.51% in it, and there is a popular saying that we should pray that we should eat right and live better. To reduce the kind of living right, eating right, and live better. You know, because people have also said that what causes problems in our body are those things that passes through our mouth. And about 60% have been put aside that causes some disorders in our bodies. So we must be careful. But I want to let you know, if we can still go back to those days, go to mindful, we will get that kind of thing, a whole carton, if you drink it, you will never be intoxicated. And that is the right kind of thing that I want to introduce to you. So please don't be misled that I'm trying to introduce my wine to you. But by the time you see the what is in this my wine, you will be convinced that it's not what we should discard at all. Okay? So, Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, most Christians and Muslims do not drink the palm wine because the alcoholic content and so of the salt has been of this palm have been neglected in several for several years by a section of Nigerian economy. But to enable me carry out researches on the salt of the raffia okra palm that will be accepted by all in its natural state, I have to deactivate the enzymes and the yeast that causes fermentation of the salt by heat treatment without any preservative. Before now, people like IPEN 2000, workers like IPEN 1982, Levy and Etor 1957, Okafor 1975, Ezechi 1978, they have attempted to bottle this palm wine. They have used heat treatment, but with a sulfite preservative, which was able to keep it for 1 year in some cases, and the others 9 months. But what we are presenting and what NIFOR is currently using was the outcome of this research. In other words, it just heat treatment at a specific temperature of 75 degrees centigrade at a constant a period of 40 minutes. The result became one of the major breakthroughs in the palm wine preservation because the cost of chemical preservative was saved from the cost of production. Additionally, most preservatives that we used then, like sodium metabisulfite, that was a known carcinogen, was eliminated from the preservation activity. Though it was banned in foods by advanced countries like the USA, it was still being used in Nigeria for palm wine processing until my findings was reported. Then we decided to work on the same line. It's not just enough to have a product. What will be the shelf life? People have tried using the fridge, the refrigerator to keep it. I must tell you the secret of that. It will only just, it will only just reduce the activity of the enzymes. Then the enzymes are still working. And that is why if you attempted to bottle the wine, the syrup, and you don't do it at the adequate temperature and time, you are going to find that within the next 1 month, the bottles will be exploding. That will happen, can happen to the products. But however, we try to work on the shelf life, and we found that it is possible that this product can be preserved for 24 months if we keep to 75 degrees centigrade of pasteurization and 40 minutes. About 2007. Then we went ahead to also continue to investigate this sub. We tried to look at this in major area. I want us to work in the second part of that topic. In the 30. Daily life supporter. In the dictionary written by compiled by Miriam Webster, she defines life support as a system used in providing sustenance of life. The systems include equipment, drug, and or materials. Food supplements fall into this category of life support. The preparation, productions, and sales of all kinds of food supplements are on the increase and are available in the market to support life on a daily basis. Most of these supplements are minerals and biotic substances, which are expensive and made for daily support of life. It was against this background that I decided to develop a nutritional norm from the sap of the goji tree, which is rich in all kinds of nutrients. We have to, when I started looking at what we have in the market today, and reading from literature, I found that the Americans, they developed a table that they call the RODA, that is the recommended dietary allowances for all kinds of minerals, all kinds of vitamins and all that. When I found that these minerals are also possible in the sap of the goji tree, and I said I'm going to develop a kind of norm out of it. So I was able to work out the number of meals you will take to acquire any of the elements, vitamins too, and all kinds of things that we have inside. So if you go back, if you go to the paper, about 2007, you will find the details of that. Because of time, I will not want to go into details, but consult my paper, you will find that there. So besides the sugar, protein, vitamins, mineral elements, we detected in the sap of the goji tree, mineral elements, which are in varied concentrations. The minerals included potassium, magnesium, sodium, calcium, phosphorus, chlorine, manganese, copper, iron, zinc, and iron. So you will find on my paper 2007 the recommended dietary allowance that you will take for you to be in good health. Not only in good health, to also support your life. There is no single food in Nigeria today that you will take that will give you the amount of nutrients that you have in the sack of this golden tree. In a single meal, you cannot have it. So we have been able to find out that from age to age, from adult to childhood, worked out the number of meals you are going to take. Where in volume too much, we are advised on that paper that you should take small quantity at intervals, and you will get there from here. It's a Vice-Chancellor, sir. Living organisms cannot synthesize elements like other nutrients that are needed for healthy living. They are therefore ingested from external sources. The golden tree is a resource of these minerals that are very expensive in the market. We know that minerals function is natural components of the body organs and tissues. Constituents of body fluids and tissues, electrolytes and catalysts in enzymes and hormones. There are various functions that these minerals carry out. So from that paper you can read, we'll find that even for a little child, there's an application for a little child. Then we decided to also look at, since it has been in the history that we only bottled well that people have produced out of that, we decided to look at what we can, and the cost of bottles we are now on increase. And to package them to carry outside is very expensive. So I decided to develop two products. The one of them was the syrup, and the other was the dried sap. And the two products are such that you can rehydrate it when you want to take it. We are looking at what happens to powdered milk that you have in the market. So we also went as far as to work on the powdered one. So if you are in the office, you can just bring out a sachet and mix up with a glass of wine, glass of water, you rehydrate it and drink. So we went up to that extent. But that I may not want to mention here. Those who are interested, they want to consult me, they will discuss better. So but the syrup is such that you can use it to take your tea. Just like you use onion. You can take one spoon of it and add to your tea and you stir it. And you still have the flavor, or if you love pansa very well, you still have the flavor of the pansa entering your tea. So also akamu, popular akamu, you can also use for it. So the dried one is just like, we are trying to get chocolate out of it. But you know, the assistants will not have yet to do it. And I made contact with the outside when they gave me the cost. It was very high. So the dried one is sort of, you can even use your spoon to cut and leave like chocolate. So I think we can go ahead. So with the dried two products, that is the syrup and the dried sap, then the powdered one is the liquid. Then, Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, I will not end this brief lecture without looking at what 11, 2012 and 13, because we saw the rate at which people were digging boreholes in their compounds. Almost every compound in the city has boreholes. That one attracted my attention. We will have to look at these boreholes. What are the contents? What are the water from these bubbles are definitely clean? That's what attracted the chemist. So, Obahiagbon in Lorin, 2011, decided to look at 32 commercial bubbles in Benin City. We obtained samples of water from the various bubbles and we analyzed them. We found that most of them, they were not permissible level for elements. Those that you would take that will not be harmful to you. Some of them, scale above the permissible level, even in water, some of the elements. And some are just at the marginal level, some of them below. So you find that most of this water you have, the commercial boreholes, and besides that, our politicians, all our politicians here are of our country. The politicians can go from one camp to another camp. They'll say, if I see borehole for you, vote for me. So we started looking at what they were also doing. That most of this water they come to dig and all that is never analyzed. For the food chemist, it's not reliable. You must take time to look at what you have in your water before you start drinking it. You may be unlucky, you have very deadly, very deadly elements like lead and all that, arsenic, maybe in the water. And so it became a common thing in municipality that people who want more votes for their party, they start going from one village to another village. I will see more for you. Please, I want to say here, I want to advise us. If some people come, first of all, agree with them, they should go and carry out water analysis. And on the day of commissioning, They should bring the water analysis. They should bring the second analysis for you to accept the ball. Don't be glad that, oh, as soon as they are opening the tap, you start drinking to at once. You don't know what you are doing to your body as you do that. So please, so we look at 32 boreholes and we find that very few of them are able to pass through the municipal level. And we buy water outside and all that. Where they even use a mechanic dump, where people, you know, carry out all kinds of things into the soil, and they use that place as water bubble, even where they have latrines. Please, this is part of the thing that we must be able to watch. If you are going to dig a borehole, don't ever dig a borehole very close to the mechanic workshop. Give some distance, about 200 feet from such sites. Because most of the things that we have here, they will wash down into the soil. Then, apart from the first thing we did in our environment, and the second thing was this issue of no, Nigerians want to eat whatever their money can buy. Any food their money can buy, can bring from inside the car, you just buy it and begin to eat it immediately. Without even checking whether there is any label on it, not knowing what was used to produce the food, we don't buy it and begin to eat because of hunger. So, but we were also interested in looking at the kind of food people are eating, and we found that larger community of Nigerians, they eat more carbohydrate foods. Now, how do we approach our community? How do we tell them what we have been doing that this will help them? So we started to use the concept of disarming illness to look at the kind of food that people eat. And we found that those that live on carbohydrate food every day, there are a lot of disorders that may happen when they continue on that. Because we looked at disarming illness is a kind of scale that people have put in place to know the amount of carbohydrate that we eat that would, you know, increase the amount of carbohydrate in our blood. So we found that because we can eat garri and akara anytime, any day, we avoid eat garri every day, we found that when we worked at the GI or disarming illness of garri, it also is about, it's a very high one, and it's not encouraging that someone should feed on garri just like that. When the child is something, just give garri to drink. You only introducing all kinds of things in the body. So we worked on single diets, single food, akamu. We worked on things that have to do with when you now process akamu to, I mean, it starts to give you akiti and the rest. But one thing that interested me, some few years ago, that was last year, we looked at a meal that is popularly eaten here. That is the garri and the tilapia fish, Titus fish. So Obahiagbon and Obahiagbon 2018 reported on the mixed food of garri and tilapia fish and found that the glycemic index and load of the diet was 62 and 30 and 35 respectively. This result indicates that it has a medium GI, which could be eaten by diabetics and non-diabetics. When garri was eaten as a single diet, a GI of 90 was calculated, showing that the garri has high GI, which is not healthy for diabetic patients to eat. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, as part of our community research, on locally produced drink, we found that the palm sap of the golden tree has a GI of 36, Obo et al., 2011, which signifies that the palm wine will be drunk by both diabetes and non-diabetes. So you find that this same golden tree, the sap of it, is taken out to another study, and we have found that even though you are diabetic, you are very free to drink that sap. So it's free for both diabetic and non. These are graphs that will update from the effect of the sugar of consuming the sap, how it affects the blood system of the human. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, Obahiagbon 2013 and 2015 investigated the concentration of formaldehyde in rainwater. This is part of our community work. Formaldehyde is present everywhere, even where we are sitting now, formaldehyde is there. And most people in the hospitals, they know what they do with money, it's purely for preservative. And many of any dead man is produced, is preserved with formaldehyde. It's the best chemical that ever been discovered that can preserve any tissue. And so this is available, even in the air, in the chairs, they are all, it's available. But so we're not trying to look at, having known the background of formaldehyde, we say we will look at water that we harvested. People harvest water from rains and all that. We say we'll look at for 2 years, we're going to look at water that we harvested at nightfall. And so we saw that between October 2008, 2009, 2010, we obtained samples and we found that the formaldehyde name in the rainwater that we were following my book was such that, well, it was within the permissible level. And we ended that there was no cause for alarm. But we will not stop there. When it comes to PD City now, or even before now, some 2 years back, there was strong competition between those people that dress the kind of makeup that they use. They have eyelashes, they have the one they use in, painting the cheeks, and painting the ear, and as those are the sticks. So we said, let us also look at this. So we tried to look at 50 samples, 20 samples of each. And we found that in the market, no product in the market that the women uses, that they will put the content of what they use in mixing that makeup is formaldehyde. They never put it, the content of the formaldehyde on the body of it, of what the people buy. That is the secret of the people that produce those things. So we analyzed them, the lipstick, the eyeshadow, about four products, we analyzed them. But we find that some are very high. The permissible level is just 2%. Some are reading 4%. Some 5%, something like that. But we found that it's not just because you are using it now that it will cause the problem. It may, if you allow it to have a cumulative effect. Those that will use it to go and add their attach to their eyelids. The attachment that they use is the formaldehyde they use in preparing it. So by the time you attach it to your eyelids, you are only saying that that formaldehyde will begin to work into your tissue then. And if it's done on a continuous basis, it's going to cause some disorder in your body. A time will come, they say the person has eye cancer. They begin to wonder, because formaldehyde is carcinogenic. And so, we looked at some things in our community. And we are right that we are able to come across among the students when they use such things to rub their face, to rub their, they want to wear the color of dress that will match the what they rub. Don't know you are carrying cancer along for the future, but God forbid you don't have cancer. So I want to advise for as many of us that we're not saying we are trying to discourage makeups here. If you have to use makeup, buy the one that they will quote there, the concentration of formaldehyde in that makeup. If it's not there, do not buy. If you go outside Nigeria, you'll find that the white man will quote it there. But here, it's never quoted. Most of them are going in the yes. Sorry if you are going in the. And so, please, that's our findings. It quote. When you have it as a cumulative, it could cause cumulative effects on our tissues. If we use a continuous basis, it could happen. So we are calling on the government, therefore, all government agencies in charge of regulation of foods, drugs, and control should insist that manufacturers of these products should write or quote on labels the concentrations of formaldehyde in their cosmetic products. Formaldehyde is present in man as a metabolite, food, land, atmosphere, water, clothing, beauty materials. You can imagine all kinds of like profanity. Consumer products, in other words, like preservative, tobacco, cigarette, shoe care agents, body and hair lotions. It is the most common aldehyde in the atmosphere. It has high solubility in polar solvents and readily reactive. It is easily photo-oxidized under sunlight. Sources of exposure to man and animal include inhalation, injection, and occupational, which is the main source of exposure. Formaldehyde is readily metabolized after injection. It is absorbed from the respiratory tract on inhalation, but it is poorly absorbed during derma exposure. Acute inhalation results in irritation and burning of mucous membrane of the nose, mouth, and upper respiratory tract. These are now the food chemist judgments. This is the latter part of this lecture. Now, the chemist is not a judge by having to go to law school. But when we use test tubes, when we use chemicals, we are able to pass judgment. So we have been able to use test tubes, we have been able to use chemicals, we have been able to use equipment to analyze what we saw in the laboratory, and we have found that the sample of the gold is a tree. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, I have reported so far my researches and findings on the golden tree that have been neglected by numerous plant scientists over the years. However, to be able to pass a good judgment as a food chemist on the significances of the golden tree, the following facts from my findings are hereby echoed to show that the sap of the golden tree is a daily life supporter. The sap of the golden tree plays useful roles in promoting the flow of the mammalian gland of lactating mothers. We need to report this because it's part of the work. Lactating mothers, when you have a wife delivered and the breast is not flowing the first 1 week, come and buy, then you don't buy the fermented wine, you buy the pansap and give to the wife. Find out within 1 week the flow will start. Apart from that, we have also found that it is used for control and cure of measles. Those suffering from measles, when they take it, that's the way to which they have a way to blow it to the child and the measles will come out. The sap of the golden tree could be drunk by humans of all ages to meet the recommended daily dietary allowances for minerals and vitamins. The sap of the golden tree could act as an energy drink due to its sucrose content. The sap of the golden tree could act as a bodybuilder due to its protein content. 21 elements were detected which could play significant roles in metabolic processes and in the structural components of the body, as part of the structural components of the body. In the mid-80s, when the bottle sap of this golden tree were exported to the USA, it was classified as a medicinal drink after analyzing the constituents and its suitability for consumption. The palm sap of the golden tree has a GI of 36 and so could be drunk by both diabetes and non-diabetes as source of several nutrients. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, permit me at this junction, while resting my case on the aforementioned facts as a food chemist, to pass my judgment that the sap of the golden tree could act as a medicinal tree that could support life on a daily basis with natural nutrients if the sap is unfermented. I'm grateful to the Almighty God who gave me insight and wisdom for this work. I remain eternally grateful to you for the opportunity you provided for me to present this lecture. May our good God provide helpers for you and your family always. Thank you for announcing me as a full professor in 2017. a sitting member of University Management, and the directors of EMC and Central Medical Laboratory. Professor and Mrs. O.G. Oshodi, sir, you have remained unforgettable in my heart for your love. Thank you, sir, for employing me as a UniBen staff and for announcing me an associate professor during your tenure. May God continue to announce you. My supervisors, I remain grateful to professors and Professor A.U. Osaki of Blessed Memory, who supervised my MSc work. In addition, I want to thank all the professors in biochemistry department for teaching me during the era of Professor A.U. Osaki as the head of the department. I wish to also thank Professors M.E. Umu and A.P. Oyawe for supervising my PhD work and for treating me as a brother and as a colleague throughout my training. Principal officers of the university, I wish to thank all the principal officers of the University of Benin since I was employed in 2014 to date, and in particular, Professor J.O. Erebo, the immediate past Deputy Vice-Chancellor Administration, who was my classmate in the secondary school, and the current serving principal officers, led by the Vice-Chancellor, Professor FFO Orumwense, FMSC, the Deputy Vice-Chancellor Administration, Professor Ibomosa Omoroji, DVC Academic, Professor Michael Emefiele Aziki, and Deputy Vice-Chancellor Ekewan, Professor Abel Abolaba, the Registrar, so Secretary of Council, Mrs. O.A. Oshodi, the Bursar, Dr. Victor Emambe, and the Librarian, Dr. Luke Obaswi. I must confess that I have enjoyed working with all of you at management meetings and while serving in other committees. My primary and secondary school teachers, I thank all my primary school teachers at St. Matthew's Cathedral School, Benin City, in particular Mr. Benu, who was our headmaster then, and Mrs. Akosawa, who taught me from the tree and appointed me the class monitor. In addition, I wish to thank all my secondary school teachers at Western Boys High School, Benin City, between 1996 and 1970. In particular, Mr. Dr. Onukoku, who taught me in chemistry, and the Emeritus Professor Owe, who taught me physics in class 3. My classmates, I thank all my former classmates at the primary school and secondary school levels, many of who are still my friends and are present here today, like Professor Mrs. Adaibo, and also those I met at the University of Ibadan, Professor Dashak T.A., who was my leading mate. As I write, the Old West Association of 1970 set of Western Boys High School still meet by monthly, and we felicitate and share jokes of the olden days in school. My parents, it is with deep pain that I observe that my parents, they don't live enough to witness this event. My father died when I was 4 years old, and I had not enjoyed the care of him. But God took over as my guardian and father. My mother became a widow for 50 years. before she went to be with the Lord at the age of 19. My early education was sponsored by her and her sister, who was our second mother, Madam Izeokun Okumbe Orumwense ni Obano. We used to go her here every day. Thank you, ma'am, for assisting, that the assistance you render to your sister, for training me during my secondary school days. And faculty and staff and faculty staff, I wish to thank the Dean of Faculty of Life Sciences, Professor C.E. Okaka, other professors of the faculty, and the academic and non-academic staff of the Faculty of Life Sciences for their support. In particular, all staff of the Department of Science and Applied Technology and the Equipment Maintenance Center under the Vice-Chancellor's Office. Preparation of the manuscript. I wish to thank Dr. Mrs. Arogie Obahiagbon, my wife, for proofreading this manuscript. And the computer specialist who prepared the manuscript, Mr. Theophilus Omango, Mr. Evans Amoniki, his name is one, and Mr. Leiter, my siblings. I wish to appreciate my brother, Mr. B.A.O. Obahiagbon, the father of Honorable Patrick Obahiagbon, for the big whose exemplary life influenced me positively. Growing frantically, I frankly made every effort to be like him. He has been like a father to me and a mentor. I wish to also thank Madam Grace Obahiagbon, who helped me to secure a temporary appointment as a primary school teacher before I got my first job at my school. I thank you, ma'am, for being a mother to me. I will not forget the role played by my immediate elder brother, C.P. Christopher Obahiagbon. A blessed family for the sacrifices he made when with my mother to educate me. The Christian family, permit me, Mr. Vice-Chancellor, to extend my appreciation to the following Christian families, under whose mentorship the Almighty God has preserved me to date. The Scriptural Union of Nigeria, Benin City, the Church of World Mission International Incorporated, under the leadership of Archbishop Dr. M.E. Iklausa, O.O.M., Bishop Professor V.I. Yahweh, Reverend Professor J.O. Boyer, and Reverend Professor M.S.O. Asien, the bishops, the zonal coordinators, national presbyters, pastors, ordained ministers, and members of CGM, and in particular, my church members. Professors, and the special uniform brethren that are here now, yes, will be people. And you always get up. And that there are 150 people from our department, and also outside the department, we sent to be here to bring this occasion. I wish to thank all of you for the sacrifices that you have made. My professional bodies, I wish to thank the leadership and members of the Institute of Science and Technology and the Chemical Society of Nigeria for being part of this event. Mr. DJ Sir and the Chairman of Council, please can you stand up for that? These are the men of the city. The teaching of the institute where the man of the right is the chairman of the council. Please sit down, my wife and children, I'm grateful to God Almighty who gave me a young, beautiful, intelligent, and godly children. Today, my wife, since 1981, by the design of God, we are blessed with four children, four beautiful and handsome children. Dr. Professor Francis Irobun Obahiagbon, Consultant Pathologist, UPTH. Dr. Engineer Wadia Obahiagbon, Intel, Arizona, USA. Dr. Sarabu Obahiagbon, UPTH. And then And three brown children. The girl is no other than Reverend Dr. Mrs. Ruth E. Obahiagbon, retired. I thank my in-laws for giving me root as a wife. This is their picture on the left of my first son and the wife. The extreme right is the third boy, and the last girl there is the fourth boy. So I want to thank all of you.
We also have Reserve Wing Commander Ansnem Osasui, Officer Commanding Medical Center of Air Force Base in the city. May I quickly let you know that Osasui is my namesake. And he is an alumnus of the great University of Benin. He is a medical doctor. We also want to recognize the presence of Professor and Mrs. Via Iyawe. We want to welcome you. Honorable and Mrs. Vincent Deko Obahiagbon, we want to recognize and welcome you. Thank you very much for coming around. I want to also recognize the presence of Honorable Matthew Doike, one-time governorship aspirant in Edo State. We want to welcome you. Thank you very much for coming. The chairman of CANSO, Institute of Science Laboratory Technology of Nigeria, will recognize you and welcome you very seriously. We recognize the DGCEO, Nigeria Institute of Science Laboratory Technology. We welcome you, sir. Thank you very much for coming around. We also want to recognize the presence of Honorable Justice Cromwell Idausa, retired CJ Edo State. We want to welcome you, sir. Thank you very much. Dr. J. Aye, we want to welcome you. We thank you for coming. Senator Egi Ozame, we are indeed grateful to God that you are come. We thank you for coming. Professor M.E. Ugun, we want to welcome you. The inaugural lecturer asked that I specifically recognize all of this. The dean of the faculty, you've been recognized. The Faculty of Physical and Life Sciences will recognize you. Professor Egafuna, we want to welcome and recognize you very specially as well. May I recognize the presence of the former Deputy Vice-Chancellor Administration, Professor John Hoya. We want to welcome you. Professor McDonald Idu, Director, Exchange and Linkages, University of Benin, and former Vice-Chancellor of Benin-Idausa University. We want to welcome you. May I quickly recognize the presence of the former Deputy Vice-Chancellor Administration, Professor Jacob Eyorobo. We want to welcome you. The list before me is endless. We shall continually recognize each and every one of you. If I have not mentioned your name, please bear with us. We recognize that you are here. There was a former chief of staff to Edo State government. He was a former member of Edo State House of Assembly. He was a former member of National Assembly. And the father is here. And he is also here. Honorable Barrister Patrick Obahiagbon. I want to welcome you, sir. Thank you for coming to the great University of Benin. Professor M.S.O. ICN, we want to also welcome and recognize you. Thank you very much. Members and Associate Pastor of Church of God Mission International, ACO Province, we want to welcome you. Association of Formidable Educational Development representatives, we want to welcome you all. Obebonusen Forum members, we want to welcome you. Pastors' Wives Association, where are they? Pastors' Wives, we want to recognize you. For those that have not joined the association, please encourage your husbands to be pastors, so you can also be a member of the Pastor's Wives Association. DPP, you are better become a pastor so that your wife can join this association. Akin, we recognize you, sir. Immediately after this time out, the inaugural lecturer is inviting each and every one of us to the indoor sports complex for a wonderful reception. For our students, I am happy to announce to you that your examinations are over and you are supposed to be on holiday. For those who are not on holiday, you have been given an automatic ticket to join the guests at the indoor sports hall. So,